good morning to you. I trust you were able to make it to service okay today. Many of our folks are just flooded inside their homes. If you live in Davie or Sunrise, even a little bit of Plantation, our phone has just rung off of the hook. Seems like we got a little reprieve right now. You must be more of a righteous crowd than the 830 crowd. I can tell that by looking at you. And so what a delight it is. We've had some interesting moments here at the church. I'll tell you about them. We need to do some praying today and some preaching today and just some things that I believe God is doing and some things that the enemy, I think, is trying to do. And so praise the Lord. Greater is he that is in us than he that is in the world. And I'm glad you're here. We got numerous people watching online today, or at least they said they were going to stay home and watch online. They're probably back in their bed, but they need to be waking up. All right, so page number 21. I know there's not 1,000 tongues now, but one day there will be. Let's stand. Let's sing our great Redeemer's praise and give glory to our God and King.
Our fears, that bids our sorrow cease. 'Tis music in the sinner's ears, 'tis life and health and peace. He breaks the power of canceled sin, he sets a prisoner free. His blood can make the foulest clean, his blood availed for me. Death, his phrase you dumb, your loosened tongues employ. He blind beholds your Savior come, and lead me lame for joy. My gracious Master and my God, assist me to proclaim, to spread through all the earth abroad, the honors of thy name.
Amen. Let us pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for this morning. Lord, thank you for allowing us to come together and gather in the dryness. Lord, Father, we thank you for the rain. But yet, Lord, we thank you for the local church. Father, we praise you that we can come together and glorify your name in liberty. And Father, we praise you for the fact that you loved us in such a way that you were willing to send your Son. And Father, we know that we have our minds and our emotions are maybe not here, but Father, we pray that you settle our hearts and our minds to be able to receive what Pastor has in store and has been preparing. And Father, for what you have for each and every one of us here today, Lord, I pray that you would intervene in a great way. And I pray that at the end of it all, your name would be glorified. Father, we love you and we certainly thank you for your Son. It is in his name we pray. Amen. Please turn around and greet those around you.
Come back to your place, take your hymn book, find page 48. You hear Brother Jeff playing, "Mighty is our God, mighty is our King. He is in the Lord, he's ruler of everything." From the book of Revelation comes this little chorus. Lift your voice now, let's sing our great praise.
Mighty is our God, mighty is our King. Mighty Jesus, our Lord, ruler of everything. Glory to our God, glory to our King, glory to our Lord, ruler of everything. His name is higher, higher than any other name. His power is greater, for he has created everything. Mighty is our God, mighty is our King, mighty is our Lord, ruler of everything, ruler of everything.
Amen. Be seated. I trust that chorus will just set our hearts in the right places. We're gathered this morning to praise the Lord. So good to see you. Welcome to Plantation Baptist Church. If you're visiting with us for the very first time, the pew in front of you is a connection card. If you'd be so kind as to reach out, grab that card, fill it out, put it in the offering plate when it goes by. That'll give us a record of your attendance today. We're delighted to have you and trust that you'll be blessed for being here. It is a huge day for our church and a lot going on. Today is supposed to be our graduation for our Christian school. We have kindergartners that will be graduating tonight. We have seniors that will be graduating tonight. We have First Baptist of Coconut Creek that's supposed to join us. We've got moms or grandmas and grandpas and friends all over the city and the state and the nation. We're supposed to have a big service. I hope we have a big boat to get to our big service, right? So I don't know. The Bible says, I read it again this morning, this is the day that the Lord hath made. Let us grab an umbrella and rejoice. And so if you look very carefully, you'll find it right there. And we're having our service because we have the Sherwood family with us today. Brother Sherwood, stand up. This is our missionary to Panama, his wife and their family. And did you bring this rain to us? Okay, so you could leave now. That'll be just fine. Be seated. And their son's graduating with our kids tonight. And Dylan is, and we're looking forward to that. And just a delight that we could join together on this evening. So, church family, if you're part of our church, you're part of our school ministry. I can't wait for you to see tonight what God is doing and what we're trusting God to continue to do. That service is going to begin at 6 o'clock. And then after the service, there's a fellowship in the hall there with food and refreshments. Come and ready to be blessed. Pastor, I have any kids or anything like that. Yeah, but you're part of our church. Therefore, you're part of this ministry. You ought to come and see what the Lord is doing. All kinds of announcements that I need to make in the bulletin. This Wednesday night, we have a camp fundraiser dinner. Kids are trying to raise money to go to camp. And we have an Italian dinner. Spaghetti is there. We've got some of the food I think is being brought in. My advice to you is give your donation before dinner. Just kidding about that, right? And but these kids are working, and we support young people that are working and active, involved, and they're trying to raise money to help go to camp. I'm asking you to participate. I think you can sign up at the welcome desk that'll give us a number and help, but come and help them to raise some money so that they can go to the wilds this year. Of course, next Sunday night for Memorial Day weekend, we have no evening service. Men, we're going bowling on May 31st. We have another wedding, a wonderful wedding. Jackie Powell is being married to Caleb Mallory, and that's on June 2nd here at the church at 9:30. Church family, you're welcome. Love and come and celebrate this union. We love to see our young people getting married. They met in our youth department here at Plantation Baptist Church, and so they have been dating, I think, for an eternity, and now they're going to get married. And so Jackie's finally broken, and she's ready to go. All right, June 3rd is grad day. We got, man, a whole page of people that have graduated from high school all the way to a PhD in some kind of psychology or counseling. You need that if you're going to be a member of with me as your pastor. I need help. And so we need your graduate's name. Call the church office. Say, hey, my son, my daughter, my spouse, my grandkid, if they're going to be here that day, let us know so that we can honor them and love on them in just a wonderful way and celebrate this wonderful union and that they have accomplished. And so I think that'll take us for our announcements, so you can visit the app and other things to be kept abreast of all that is going on. The choir did a marvelous job at 8:30, singing a song entitled The Midnight Cry, that reminder of that moment when the Lord Jesus is coming back. I trust that you're ready for that. I trust you're expecting that. Follow along in your mind and follow what the choir has to say, thinking about that moment when the Lord Jesus shall come and catch away his church. God bless you, choir, as you lift your voice.
Closer now.
That cry could come at any time. We believe the Lord could come at any time and we'll be going home. I pray that you're spiritually prepared for that as you know the Lord Jesus in your heart. You know him as your personal Lord and Savior. The Holy Spirit of God has inhabited you and you're just waiting to hear that midnight cry. Page 368. I love this song because it's a wonderful song of confidence. I think it's a song that was written to reflect kind of the controversy of the day or the attack of the world. And the songwriter said, I serve a risen Savior. He's in the world today. I know that he is living, whatever men may say. I trust the song will just lead you to worship the Lord, lead you to understand his presence in your life. Stand if you would. Let's lift our voice. When we get to the third chorus, I trust you're able to rejoice.
I serve a risen Savior. He's in the world today. I know that he is living, whatever men may say. I see his hand of mercy. I hear his voice of cheer. And just in time I need him, he's always near. He lives, Christ Jesus lives today. He walks with me and talks with me along life's narrow way. He lives, salvation to impart. You ask me how I know he lives. He lives within my heart. In all the world around me, I see his loving care. And though my heart grows weary, I never will despair. I know that he is leading through all the stormy blast. The day of his appearing will come at last. He lives, Christ Jesus lives today. He walks with me and talks with me along life's narrow way. He lives, salvation to impart. You ask me how I know he lives within my heart. Rejoice, rejoice, O Christian, lift up your voice and sing. Eternal hallelujahs to Jesus Christ the King, the hope of all who seek him, the help of all who find. The Father is so loving, so good and kind. He lives, Christ Jesus lives today. He walks with me and talks with me along life's narrow way. He lives, salvation to impart. You ask me how I know he lives. He lives within my heart.
Amen. What a great truth. I trust you know that. Man, if you'll wait on us for our offering, we'll have our prayers to the people. I do need to bring two requests to you. Within about the last 12 hours, we've had to call the paramedics two times to Plantation Baptist Church for two of our members. Last night, we were having a Sunday school party here in Brother Keith Scheffler's class. And I do not know how to explain this to you, but Brother Keith was in the middle of teaching his lesson and just collapsed. Right there, just fell straight on the ground. He's in intensive care right now at one of the local hospitals, and with bleeding on his brain, he did hit his head on the way down. I understand him to be in good spirits, but I understand they're waiting on some results from a CAT scan. God sustained his life tremendously last night. During the 8:30 service, we had to once again call the paramedics for Judy Dulligite. Judy's a little lady, sits in the very back row back there on Wednesday night. She always raises her hand for two unspokens if you come on Wednesday night. God answered one of those unspokens. She suffered a health emergency this morning. I believe she's at home, but we need to lift these two folks up in prayer. This fits into my message this morning for what I think is a great benefit and a blessing to us, but an understanding as the people of God for the days in which we live in on a spiritual level here. And so please, please pray with me with these two. I'm going to pray and ask God to bless our service. Would you pray now? Heavenly Father God, what a joy it is to be with our church family today. God, I am, seems like the longer that I live and grow in the Lord and the more that I am able to relate with my church family, the more that I love my church family. I thank you so much for brothers and sisters in Christ. God, I thank you for the unity of the gospel. I thank you for the unity of the blood of Jesus. I thank you for the unity of the Spirit of God. God, I thank you for your promise where there are at least two or three gathered together in your name, there you would be in the midst. And of course, we have many more than that today, but we're without many of our people that couldn't get here. But I guess the one thing I want to say, Lord, is I appreciate your eternal presence in my life. And I appreciate your presence when the church gathers together. And oh, how we needed your presence last night. We needed it this morning. God, thank you for sustaining the life of Keith Scheffler last night. I reckon that to be the great physician. I lift him to the throne of grace. Something happened, God. Something happened within his body. And I know that man, through your enablement, has created machines and scans and tests, and we have all of that. But there is not a machine or a person that can see like the great physician can see. So diagnose, help. And lift him to the throne of grace. Pray for his wife, his children. Lord, thank you for the capable staff that was here last night. You just had everything, you had everything perfect. Father, little Judy Dulligite told me a few months ago, she said, I found how I will serve the Lord. And almost every day that woman comes to this church and works on the Christmas lights. Christmas ain't even for months away. And every day she's working on those lights. So when the thousands of people come, they can see the light of Jesus. She's attacked in her health today. Lord, I pray that you would sustain her. I pray that you'd care for her. Great physician, watch over her, meet her every need. Lord, we give you glory. It's a glorious day. It's a day of great celebration. It's funny how you can go from a heavy need to a glorious celebration, and how we relate to that, just the Holy Spirit will help us. Help me preach, God. I really believe that the message today is so perfectly placed by you. And so I beg you to help. Thank you for your love, your kindness, your grace, your mercy. Thank you for your goodness. God, if there's somebody in the room today and they do not know Jesus Christ as their Savior, I beg you, Holy Spirit of God, just unfold him in the heart and mind of those folks. Let them sense your presence and your love. Let them know that the longing in their heart can be filled only by him, and may today be their day of salvation. Bless this offering. Receive it for your glory. Bless Brother Rod as he sings. Lord, may it just prepare our hearts now. In Jesus' name, amen. God bless you. You may be seated. I want you to listen to this offertory simply entitled, We Believe. If you know the Lord and you believe the Bible, listen to every statement and find agreement in what he's about to sing. God bless you.
Father,
created all that is, and we believe the universe and all therein is His. This loving Heavenly Father, He yearned to save us all, to lift us from the fall. We believe. We believe in Jesus, the Father's only Son, existing uncreated before time had begun, a sacrifice for sin. He died and rose again to ransom sinful man. We believe. We believe in the Spirit who makes believers one. Our hearts are filled with His presence. The Comforter has come. The kingdom unfolds in His plan, unhindered by quarrels of man. His church upheld by His hand. We believe. Though the earth be removed and time be no more, this truth are secure, God's word shall endure. Whatever may change, these things are sure. We believe. So if the mountains will cast down into the plains, when kingdoms all crumble, this one remains. Our faith's not subject to season of men. With the fathers we proclaim, we believe our Lord will come as He said. The land and the sea will give up their dead. Children will reign with Him as their head. We
if you believe, say amen. We believe, man. I trust that you believe. Take your Bible, if you would, this morning. Find the 12th chapter of the book of Revelation. Revelation chapter number 12 will be our text this morning as we make our way and continue through this series on the book of Revelation entitled The Time is at Hand. We took last week off for Mother's Day, and I'll speak this week and then next week and then probably preach to the graduates the first Sunday of June, and so there'll be a little bit of interruption as we make our way through the summertime, but I trust and pray and ask God that He would take the messages and make them so perfectly timed and placed in what He would have for us as we gather together. I do believe such is the case this morning. I want to preach a message today that I have entitled Angel Wars. Angel Wars. We've come to the time in the book of Revelation now where we are pretty solidly through that third section of the book, having dealt with the things that John had seen, having dealt with the things which are, which carries with it our lifetime right now prior to the rapture of the church. We have crossed over with John into the visions of those things which must come hereafter. We know that that which is hereafter is after the church has been raptured, and that we are caught away after that midnight cry, after that time that we that have the Spirit of God living within us are caught away as Jesus comes back to get his children. You either understand and love that, or you have no idea what I'm talking about and think I'm out of my mind. For those of you that think I'm out of my mind, you may have a point on some days, but not today. Because the Bible clearly teaches that there will be a supernatural day when the super Lord Jesus will appear in the clouds. And those of us that have the Holy Spirit of God indwelling our bodies, we will be caught off of this earth, and so shall we ever be with the Lord. We look forward to that day, do we not? After that time, God still has a plan for this earth. Now, I don't know how many billions of people that know the Lord. I don't know how many hundreds of millions of people that know the Lord. But when the church is caught away off of the earth, it will affect the earth. But here is what we have learned about humanity. We have learned about humanity that humanity has the ability to go forward. Humanity has the ability to get knocked down or to get hit hard. And then after a while, we tend to get calloused and we tend to go forward and we tend to begin to pick up our lives. We've seen that in our own nation. We've seen that around the world. There will be a picking up of life after the church is raptured. The Bible talks about that there will be one man that will be able to kind of rally the peoples of the earth. We know that this man will be charismatic. We know that this man will be gifted. We know this man will be an orator. We know this man will be professional. We know that somehow this man will be able to marshal the confidence of the world. Not all of it. There will be a battle that will take place. And what he cannot do basically by just a peaceful negotiating, he'll do through powerful military exercise. We know that this one man will lead the nation of Israel to sign a peace treaty, because let's just be real clear about this. I love our nation. I love the leadership of our nation, and I appreciate what our nation is doing when it comes to the support of Israel. Let's be real clear about something. The promise that God will bless them that bless his people and curse them that curses people is still a relevant promise today. And you better understand that spiritually, and you better understand that nationally. Having said that, no one loves the Jewish people like the born-again child of the living God. We love them. We know who they are. We know what promises and covenants were made to them. We understand that what God is doing and working, we understand that they're in a situation today as a people out of the consequence of unbelief. But there will be a day, the Bible says, when the nation, like one man, will see the Lord Jesus coming in the sky, and they will believe upon him whom they have pierced. That will be a great day as that nation will be saved. However, when the church is raptured off of the earth, Israel will become tremendously vulnerable. Why? Because as the church is raptured off the earth, the Holy Spirit is raptured, is gone up, and there's no more restraining of evil. You think we live in an evil world now. Let me tell you something. When the Holy Spirit of God is no longer upon the earth through the church, you have not seen evil yet. And God help those folks that have gone through the shooting again and all of the evil that's unloaded. It's just a glimpse, man. It's just a glimpse of what is going to happen in that period of time. And the vulnerability of Israel, somehow they will be deceived into believing this man, and they will ink their signature on a treaty. A treaty will be a treaty that will proclaim peace, but it is anything but truthful. It's tremendously deceiving and deceptive. They will follow that man that they signed that treaty with, that so-called prince of peace or the man of peace, but really he's a man of perdition is what the Bible calls him. And 3.5 years into that peace deal, he's going to pull his card. His card is this. He is an emissary of Satan himself. At 3.5 years, Satan himself will possess this man, and this man then will stand and make the announcement of the secret that is the motivation behind all that is going on. It's not a new secret. It's really a secret that, or a truth that has gone forward throughout the ages. I'll explain that to you in a moment. But to the nation of Israel, he will stand in their temple or set up an image in their temple, and he will declare himself to be God. He will declare that worship come to him. Daniel said he will be the oblation there, that horrific moment of desolation that will happen. Once that happens, Israel will know we screwed up, we messed up, we should not have done this. From that moment in time where that there is this possession of this man, there will be the unfolding of horrific ventures upon the earth. This unfolding of these horrific adventures will really and truthfully be coming from heaven as God is moving against Satan and moving against this man. And as God is moving in heaven and the rage of Satan is going, because for the reason I'll show you in the Bible here in a moment, there will be this collision upon the earth. So heinous and so evil will that moment be that the Bible says, woe to the inhabitants of the earth. I want to stop right here and just say, thank God I'm saved and I won't be there. Amen. Okay, so having said all of that, as we've make our way now through these events and we've been watching them in the book of Revelation, we find ourselves right at that pivotal moment where we're going to meet this Antichrist next week, and you're going to begin to see his demon possession, and you're going to begin to see how that unfolds. Now, as this is unfolding and it looks like Satan is getting an advantage, you cannot forget the verse in the book of Daniel. When Daniel looked at King Nebuchadnezzar and said, don't forget that there is a God in heaven that rules over the affairs of men. And so as things are happening on the earth, God is really the one that is instigating all of this and organizing this so that he can bring judgment against sin, restore that which was lost, and set up his kingdom upon the earth. And so we went through, last time I preached to you 2 weeks ago, if you look at Revelation chapter 11, verse number 15, we talked about that seventh angel that blew that seventh trumpet. And we said that seventh trumpet was really the announcement that the kingdoms of this world will become the kingdoms of our God and of our Christ. I took you from Revelation back to the book of Daniel, back to the vision that Nebuchadnezzar had of that image, that statue. And I told you about the head and the chest and the arms and the torso and the legs and how they represented Gentile nations. Inside of his vision, he saw a stone not made with hands coming out of the sky, smashing that image on its foot and destroying that image, and a kingdom was set up. We know all the way back in the book of Daniel that this was the prophecy of the millennial kingdom that will unfold upon the earth. John has heard this trumpet blow, and there's been this announcement that it's going to happen. Now, what you need to understand is from the time the announcement happens, it doesn't happen right at the announcement. The Bible says there's no more time, which means there's nothing stopping God fulfilling this, but God's going to use 3.5 years to bring about the finishing of the evil one and bring about the setting up of the kingdom of God. What you're going to look at in Revelation chapter 12, chapter 13, all the way to chapter number 20 are events that are happening during that time. And really what they're going to do is they're going to give you a glimpse of things that are happening behind the scenes. And it's so important. I stand up here every week and I preach to you the Word of God, and I always say that the Word of God has present day application almost on every page. If you believe that, would you say amen to that? All right, so chapter 12 is really a war. It's a battle. And what God is doing, God has given John a vision that you and I can understand. And God is peeling back the spiritual realm of our vision. And he's going to let us see the battle that has been raging in the spiritual realm ever since the exaltation of Satan's will in heaven. I hope you understand that Satan was created an angel and his name was Lucifer. I hope you understand that he was a beautiful angel entrusted with worship and music in heaven, but you know that he had a will that he wanted to be worshiped as God. And when he exalted that will, God came against that and cast him out and defeated him there. And we know all that has happened. Since that moment of the meeting of Satan's will in that defeat, Satan has not just gone away. He still has within his desire to destroy God, to exalt himself above God, and Satan wants the worship himself that is due the living and true God. By the way, there's only one God that you ought to worship. His name is Jesus Christ. So you and I, we live in our world, right? And we can see what we can see. But understand this, there is a physical world, but there is a spiritual world. It's real. And there's a battle raging. Now, when you have a battle, you have sides. And really and truthfully, as this spiritual battle is raging, you have righteousness and you have unrighteousness. You have King Jesus and you have Satan trying to be in his position. You have holiness and unholiness, righteousness and unrighteousness, godliness and ungodliness. And so behind the scenes, right this very minute, there is a spiritual battle that is happening. I want to stop and say this. We're taught this in our day in the New Testament, that the children of God have an enemy and his name is Satan. We understand there's spiritual warfare that happens. Your spiritual growth necessitates you understanding that there is a battle. Now, don't get too freaked out about that because I can go ahead and spoil it for you. Jesus Christ wins. And he's never losing. When it looks like he's losing, it's because he's positioning himself where he needs to be, but he's always in control. I will say this. Satan hates God. He hates the word of God, and he hates the church of God. He hates us. And I feel like as we're coming in, especially today in Revelation chapter 12, and Satan is getting ready to be exposed in your mind as to who he is, and you're going to see his working throughout the ages, that Satan has unleashed physical attack upon our church. And I think he has reached in and touched some in their health. He's reached in and touched us in other areas. He hates churches that preach the gospel of Jesus Christ. And he hates the people that love the gospel of Jesus Christ. And I'm begging the Holy Spirit of God to help you get a good glimpse of this rascal today, this dragon today, and that you can understand that who he is and what he has been doing. And so I want to preach to you today a message entitled Angel Wars. Would you go to verse number one, please? The Bible says, and there appeared a great wonder in heaven. If you take an ink pen or a highlighter, underline that phrase. You're going to need it. I'm going to give you two more phrases I would love for you to underline. I want you, this is my first point, the wonder in heaven. Come down, if you would, to verse number 7. And the Bible says, and there was war in heaven. You ought to underline war in heaven. Come, if you would, please, to verse number 12. And you see, therefore, rejoice ye heavens and ye that dwell in them. Woe to the inhabitants of the earth. So I have a wonder in heaven. I have a war in heaven. And I have a woe to the inhabitants of the earth. These three verses help us to break down and dissect this passage. You notice the word wonder. It's mentioned in verse number one. It's mentioned in verse number three. You may want to mark it in verse number three. The word wonder is sign or symbolism or symbolic. And so what John is seeing here is a sign, a symbolism in heaven. The Bible says, and there appeared a great wonder in heaven, a, what's that word, class? A woman, verse number one, a woman clothed with the sun, the moon under her feet, and upon her head a crown of 12 stars. And she, being with child, cried, travailing in birth, pained to be delivered. There appeared another wonder in heaven. Behold, a great red dragon, having 7 heads and 10 horns and 7 crowns upon his heads. And his tail drew the third part of the stars of heaven and did cast them to the earth. And the dragon stood before the woman, which was ready to be delivered, for to, what's that word? Devour her child as soon as it was born. She brought forth a man child who was to rule all nations with a rod of iron. And her child was caught up unto God and to his throne. All right, so we have our two wonders here. These are signs. Now, remember what Pastor said. In Revelation chapter 12, John is getting a vision that kind of peels back our eyes and lets us understand what God has been doing, lets us understand what Satan has been doing, lets us understand the battle that has been raging. So you can picture a pregnant woman. You can picture her travailing in her experience. You can picture her crying out in pains in her birth. Picture, if you would, a travailing woman getting ready to give birth, and standing in front of the woman is this ferocious red dragon, salivating with murder and desire, waiting for the child to come forth and immediately grab and murder the child. The Bible says that when the woman gave birth to that child, that child was then, that was promised, it was a man child that was promised to rule the earth, and that child was caught up to God, away from the dragon, and to be in the throne room of God. Pastor, what am I looking at? Well, let's define some characters here. You got your pen ready? Here you go. Who is the woman? Oh boy, what a question. There are three women that get attributed to being this woman. The first one is the Virgin Mary. I promise you, this is not the Virgin Mary. The second woman that gets attributed here is the church. It is not the church. The church has never given birth to a child. The church is getting married, but we will become the bride of Christ, but we've never given birth to a child. If you would write by verse number 1 of Revelation chapter 12, Genesis 37 and verse number 9, it will unfold for you who this woman is. That will take you back to Joseph and to one of his dreams. And you remember his dream of obeisance with the sun and the moon and the 11 stars. And Joseph's dad, Jacob, said, "Shall your father and your mother and your brethren bow down and worship you?" The same description of Jacob is the same description here given of this woman. Matter of fact, does anybody know the name that God changed Jacob from? He said, "Jacob, you'll no longer be called that, but you will be called Israel, because thou art a prince with God." Who is the woman of Revelation chapter number 12? She is Israel as a nation. It is Israel that brought forth the Messiah. It is Israel that birthed the man child that was promised to rule the earth with a rod of iron, speaking of that prophecy in Psalm 2, which will be unfolded in the millennial kingdom. It is Israel that groaned and travailed in that birth process. And when you study the history of the nation to the birth of the Lord Jesus, you understand their travail and their pain and their suffering, all because of their unbelief, all because of their own positioning there. But the nation has suffered tremendously. And so John is getting a vision of the nation of Israel that was promised that there would be a seed of the woman, Genesis chapter 3, verse 15, that would come forth and bruise the head of Satan. His heel would be bruised, but it would be through thy seed, that seed, Christ, that all the nations of the earth shall be blessed. If you've been blessed by Jesus Christ as a Gentile, say amen. Okay. So this is not hard to follow. John says that there stood by the woman a red dragon, murderous, bloody dragon, ready to devour the child upon birth. Your eyesight is being peeled back, and you're able to understand diabolically in the spiritual realm what unfolded when Jesus was born. When Jesus Christ was born, there was a ruler named Herod. And Herod found out that there was going to be a king that would be born. And he said, I want to worship the king. In reality, he wanted to murder the king. I submit to you that Herod as a man was a murderer, but he was an emissary of the dragon. And you know that Joseph and Mary had to move into Egypt. You understand how Jesus was born. You know that God protected him. But understand this, as that dragon was there ready to kill Jesus, and he was protected by God the Father and spared him, but Herod ended up killing all of those children 2 years of age and younger. Matthew said that was Rachel weeping for her children. And so what we see there played out at the time of Christ's birth, we're in a human level with Herod trying to murder Jesus when he was being born. John seeing it in a spiritual realm, and John says, I saw a pregnant woman travailing, ready to birth, and I saw a red dragon there ready to murder that child. It has always been, and it still is now, Satan's desire to destroy Jesus Christ. He hates him. He hates him. Goes on to say, verse number 5, that her child was caught up unto God and to his throne. Now, in this passage, John is skipping events and times, but we know that Jesus was crucified. We know that he was buried. We know that he rose again, and we know that he ascended up on high. Where is Jesus today? Seated at the right hand of the Father. Okay? Now, you're getting a glimpse of the age-old battle between the Lord Jesus and Satan, the diabolical desire to murder Jesus Christ. This is happening in the spiritual realm. And we're worried about what the stock market is going to do. And we're worried about what President Trump is going to do. And we're worried about where we're going to go, or what we're going to eat, or what we're going to buy, or we're worried about our little problems. You know, it is time for God's people to open up their eyes spiritually and realize what's going on. And as we do that, we mature in what we're doing. Between verses 5 and 6, draw your line out to some kind of blank spot on your Bible. And when you take that little line between verse number 5 and verse number 6, draw your little arrow. And at the end of the arrow, write the word church age. Because verse number 5, before you get to verse number 6, it chronologically jumps over the church age. And you read in verse number 6, again, about the movement of the woman. And the Bible says, and the woman fled into wilderness where she hath a place prepared of God, and they should feed her there 1,260 days, 3.5 years. Now, we know this number. We know the tribulation is 7 years. We know the first 3.5 years, the man of peace is deceiving the world. We know at the middle of that, he's demon-possessed, and now he tries to destroy the Jewish people. So we're kind of right here on the midst. And what the Bible says, and what God is saying, is that there, John's watching this vision, and he's watching the woman run into the wilderness where God has a special place to prepare for to keep the nation of Israel. Some Bible scholars feel this is the city of Petra. I'm not able to go there, but this is what they would say. I will say this, though, that God has got the nation of Israel still the apple of his eye, and God is still going to them, and John is envisioning now a time where they're going to have to flee into the wilderness for their very lives. Don't you remember what Jesus said? Jesus said, when this happens in Matthew 24 and 25, don't go get your coat. Don't come down if you're up. God forbid you're nursing a baby. Run! Because evil's coming. So he jumps over into verse number 6. John's peeling back our vision, and he's letting us see this battle here. We've looked past. Now we're looking forward. And then he gives us a glimpse into heaven. Look at this war that takes place. Verse number 7. John talks about these days. He says, and there was war in heaven. Michael and his angels, we know Michael to be the great archangel, fought against the dragon, and the dragon fought in his angels and prevailed not, neither was their place found any more in heaven. And here the dragon is identified, and the great dragon was cast out, that old serpent called the devil and, say it, Satan. The dragon is Satan, which deceiveth the whole world. Let me tell you something. There is no deception like satanic deception. Satan has the ability right now to offer you the kingdom of the world. He has the ability to offer you the wealth of the world. He has the ability to offer you the lust of the world. He has the ability to offer you the pleasure of the world. Satan has, as the god of this world, the ability to give you everything this world offers. But my friends, if you take everything this world offer and you reject Jesus Christ and you follow Satan, you will be so deceived and disappointed when it unfolds. God help us. The Bible says that Satan, which deceiveth the whole world, he was cast out into the earth, and his angels were cast out with him. Now, this is important. When Satan fell, or when Satan was defeated there, he took one thing, angels with him. But John's envisioning now a war that will happen. He's envisioning a war at a certain point in time where Satan will no longer have, because of the defeat of this war, access to heaven. Pastor, Satan has access to heaven now? Absolutely. Ask Job. Satan has access to heaven to be able to go in, and for a certain purpose he does. Now God's peeling your vision back, and God's letting you know that what you don't see in your life is there's a battle raging. What you're going to understand is there's going to be an ultimate defeat. Notice how the archangel is going to defeat that great dragon. And when he grabs that great dragon, he's casting him out, and all of his angels are going with him. Where is he going? He's going to the earth. There he will be no longer with access into heaven. It's interesting what heaven does when this happens. Look at verse number 10. And I heard a loud voice saying in heaven, now is come salvation and strength and the, finish that phrase please, kingdom of our God. Remember, the kingdoms of this world shall become the kingdoms of our, now, heaven says, the kingdom of our God, the power of his Christ, for the accuser of our brethren is cast down, which accused them before our God day and night. Oh, finally. God's people don't have to put up with that old devil, that old dragon, and that old serpent. Aren't you going to be glad for the day you no longer have to put up with that rascal? If so, say amen. When the war happens and Satan is no longer allowed access to the earth, two things happen. Heaven rejoices. God, don't let me get ahead of myself here. Yeah, slow me down. He's giving me so many thoughts right now, I'm about to choke. Look what the devil does. Look, if you would, at verse 12. Therefore rejoice, ye heavens, and ye that dwell in them. Woe to the inhabitants of the earth and of the sea, for the devil has come down unto you having great, what's that word? Okay, so when Satan is defeated there by Michael and he's no longer allowed access into heaven at that point in time, heaven rejoices, Satan rages. The rage part I'll deal with next week. Let's deal with the rejoicing part. The Bible says that with one voice, they begin to praise the Lord, and they praise him for his salvation, for his strength, for his kingdom, for his power. And they praise him because the accuser of our brethren, which is cast down, which accused them before our God day and night. I love this. And this part here is a good place to end, and it's a good practical application for you. What has happened? God has peeled back your blinders, and you should be able to see that from the time that Satan exalted himself to the promise of Genesis chapter 3 to the sin of Adam and all of that, there is a battle that is raging for Satan to be exalted and be worshipped as the true and living God. We see it unfolding in this vision. We see how he tried to murder Christ. We're going to find in the Great Tribulation, since he can't murder Christ, he's going to murder the people of God. But we also understand that he has now, within this battle raging, access into heaven and out of heaven. That affects you. That affects me. It affects us so much that it will even affect us when we're in heaven. When you get to verse number 10, where will you be as a person? You will be in one of three places. You will either be in heaven, you will be in hell, or you will be on the earth. You don't want to be on the earth. You don't want to be in hell. So, whose voice is proclaiming these praises? Am I the only Christian in this room? You're like, I don't know. Tell us. Right? So at this point in time, you've either died or you've been raptured off the earth. Then, even then, you will lift up your hands and you will say, thank you, God. Why? Because that dragon has been in that throne room. And he's taken Joe Charles, and he's taken Peter, he's taken Neil, he's taken you, and he's brought you before God, and he said this: you are a wicked man. This man has done this, 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 and this. And probably, knowing those men, none of that will be a lie. And he will begin to accuse you, pervert, you murderer, you hater, you angerer, you denier, you blasphemer, you all of these things. And he will begin to unload all of our sin. And he will accuse us before God, trying to destroy us and deny the deity of God and the power of the gospel. And over and over and over, you will hear accusation, accusation against how evil you are. Nobody likes to hear bad things about themselves. Pastor, I don't know that I want to hear that. Oh, yes, you do. Watch. Not only will that happen then, but that happens now. Let me make my point. Look, if you would, at verse number 11. And they, What's that word? Overcame him, the dragon, by the, say those four words, baby, blood of the Lamb. You're right. I am that. I did that. I was that. But I have been washed in the blood that cleanses me from all my sin. I deserve everything you've said. I have an evil and wicked. I have sinned against God. And there I stood. But I'm robed in the righteousness of Jesus Christ. I'm covered by the blood of the Lamb. And the blood of Jesus cleanses me from all my sin, you rascal. Amen. And the shout will come from heaven. The Bible says, by the word of their testimony, they love not their lives unto death. Satan loves his life. He wants his life to be exalted. But those of us that know the Lord Jesus, we realize that we have life because of his life. We don't care about our lives. We care about him. We want our lives to bring glory to him. And even in heaven, I got to listen to that accuser until that day, baby. Well, Pastor, how are we going to survive that? The same way you survive it now. Because right now, in my mind sometimes, Satan accuses me. Well, Tom, you know 20 years ago you did this. Well, you know, Tom, you really committed that. You know, Tom, if everybody really knew, you know, Tom, you know, Tom, you know, Tom. And in my mind, he keeps accusing me of my sin. And if I don't know how to handle that as a believer, then I begin to break down. I need to understand who he is, understand his diabolical plan. He doesn't care anything about you. He hates you and hates God. And he tries to crush your faith in God. He tries to crush the power of the gospel in your life. He tries to crush the blood and make the blood of Christ ineffective in your life. And he's accusing and accusing and accusing and accusing. And you never know the joy of your salvation. You don't know how to look at him and say, you know what? I was immoral. I was a liar. I was a murderer. I was angry. I did steal that. I did cheat that. I do deserve to go to hell, but I will never go to hell. Because I'm washed by the blood of the Lamb. And the blood cleanses me. That's why it makes me so mad when you don't sing powerfully about the blood of God. Understand, that's how we overcome the wicked one. And there are many times in my life that I fall down on my knees and I say, God, thank you for the blood of Christ that has washed me clean. Aren't you glad you're saved? Even in heaven. And finally, when Michael takes that sorry rascal and tosses him out in those angels, all of us are going to say, now is salvation and strength and power and the kingdoms of our God. And we're going to see as God's going to now begin to move and make his final movements to destroy that old rascal. I'm glad I'm on the winning side. I had to preach this message so I can preach next week. I'm going to leave you here with the application of accusation, but next week I've got 3 points that you can apply to your life right now that I really believe will help you immensely. I trust that you'll come back or swim back or walk on water, do whatever you got to do, but get here. Let's pray. Let's go home. Heavenly Father God, oh, what a delight it is to read the Word of God. Matter of fact, in chapter number 1 of the book, John said, blessed is the man that reads and obeys, that reads the book and understands the book. Most of God's people are scared out of their mind for the book of Revelation. There's no reason to be scared out of our mind. It's the unveiling of Jesus Christ. Chapter 13, the Antichrist arises out of that sea of people. We're getting there. But prior to that, you wanted God's people to be able to understand the ages in the past, the time to come. You wanted to understand that there is a spiritual battle raging. So important that we understand that as humanity. So important that we understand the deceiver I pray, God, I pray if there's anybody in this room that is following the way of the enemy and letting him deceive them to the denial of their salvation in Christ, the denial of the goodness of God, to the denial of the blood of Christ, trying to win them with the pleasures of this world or the token of this world. They have to hear a message like this and understand who he is and what he's doing, and he's going to be defeated. Why would you sacrifice all of your eternal to follow the deceiver of the whole world? Pierce the heart, God. Pierce the mind there. And then, Lord, he'll no longer be allowed to accuse the brethren. So powerful, because as I meet with people, they're so worried about their past sin, and the devil paralyzes them with that. Then I ask them, are you born again? Yes. Have you the Lord Jesus in your heart? Yes. Do you believe in the shed blood of Christ for the covering of your sin? Yes. Then your sin is under the blood. But I know. No, you don't. For you to respond, but I know, means you don't know the word of God, because the Bible says the blood of Jesus cleansed me from all my sin. And so we carry that past. No wonder Paul said, forgetting the past. I pray for the Christian now that's paralyzed in their mind because they can't get past something they did early in their life. If it's under the blood, it's under the blood. Don't let the accuser eat their lunch. He hates them. He's trying to use that to deny the power of God. It's time for God's people to be students of the Word of God. It's time for us to know. It's time for us to see. It's time for us to be people of faith. I wonder, with heads bowed and eyes closed, if I could ask you a couple of questions, I'll let you go. Number one, just because I feel like after a message like this, I want to do it. If Jesus Christ lives in your heart and you're saved, would you raise your hand and just kind of wave it to the Lord and say, thank you, God, within the quietness of your soul? You can put them down. Maybe you're here today and you're not a believer. You've never received Jesus by faith. Your eyes have been peeled back where you can see this battle throughout the ages. And you can see, though, God's love for you. He died for you. Salvation available for you. I'm asking you, would you like to be a Christian today? Would you love to come to faith in Christ? Would you love to know peace? Would you love to know salvation? Pastor, you don't know what I've done. Oh, but I preached to you about the cleansing power of the blood of Christ. There's not a sin that God cannot forgive, or a sinner that God cannot forgive. Pastor, I want to be saved. Oh, I want to be saved. Don't embarrass me. Don't call my name. But pray for me today, Pastor. I would like to become a Christian. If that's you, would you lift your hand and let me pray for you? Pastor, I would love to be a Christian. I need to be one today. God bless you. Anyone else? All right. Christian, are you allowing the accuser of the brethren to defeat you in your mind? Are you not trusting the blood of Christ? Do you not understand where you are? This is not maybe only for your past as an unbeliever, but even for those sins we commit as Christians. I know the devil attacks us. He's relentless in that. But they overcame him by the blood of the Lamb, by the word of their testimony, and by not loving their life. That's how you overcome him. Pastor, the devil has been after me in my mind, accusing me, and it has robbed me of my joy. But I have learned today the power, again, of the blood of Jesus Christ. And I'm trusting that. Pray for me, Pastor. If that's you, would you lift your hand? Let me pray for you. Pastor, pray for me. Yeah, I'm sure I see those hands. God bless you. You can put them down. All right. Heavenly Father, God, can't wait to preach next week. Oh, man, Satan knows he's got just a little time on the earth, and he rages like the maniac he is. But in all of that, you're powerful and you're protective in the peace of God. Father, those that raised their hand today, I pray you'd move in their hearts. I pray, God, that they would humble themselves. They could come and pray at the altar and do business with you. And may we leave here today steadfast and secure in the blood of Jesus Christ. Thank you, Lord. In your name we pray. Amen. Our song of invitations, page number 480. I'd ask you to stand. Only trust him. Men of God are here to pray with you. If you desire to have prayer, you could come to the altar. And we would love to do that, or pray by yourself. Lift your voice, let God have his way. Verse number 1, 480. by sin oppressed, there's mercy with the Lord, and He will surely give you rest by trusting in His word. Only trust Him, only trust Him, only trust Him now. Launch now into the crimson flood that washes white as snow. Only trust Him, only trust Him, only trust Him now.
I want to read you the passage. Know ye not that the unrighteous shall not inherit the kingdom of God? Be not deceived, neither fornicator, idolater, adulterer, effeminate, or abuser of themselves with mankind, nor thief, nor covetous, nor drunkard, nor reviler, nor extortioner shall inherit the kingdom of God. That's you and that's me, right? And then here's the next verse. And such were some of you, but you are washed, you are sanctified, you are justified in the name of the Lord Jesus and by the Spirit of our God. That'll take us home, won't it? And that'll bring you back next week. All right, let's go home. Page 575, singing about our trust on the everlasting arms. Come tonight, celebrate with our graduates. Be careful today. God bless you. Thank you for being here.
What a fellowship, what a joy divine, leaning on the everlasting arms. What a blessedness, what a peace is mine, leaning on the everlasting, sing it out now. Leaning, leaning, safe and secure from all alarms. Leaning,